members of the pacemaker in the early 1950s, and was one of the first to do open heart surgery, in particular under hypothermia. In 1950, the first open heart lung machine was developed and open heart surgery was performed. And in 1953, he formed the first division of cardiovascular surgery in Canada. And over his years of involvement in cardiac surgery, trained well over 40 cardiac surgeons. I have this video I wanted to play for you. Until
millions of people with heart disease owe their lives to Dr. Wilfred Gordon Bill Bigelow. Born in 1913 in Brandon, Manitoba, Bill went on to earn his MD from the University of Toronto in 1938, followed by a surgical residency at Toronto General Hospital. During World War II, while serving as a surgeon in casualty clearing stations, he grew interested in hypothermia, or total body cooling.
I became interested in the vascular system. This stressed me to see a limb amputated because the arteries in the child were in the bones and everything were still there. And that led me to think about hypothermia. Preserve that limb.
That video goes on for a while, so I thought I would also just show you that he's still very popular and current to this day. If you do a Google search on Dr. Bigelow, these images pop up instantaneously. So, a very famous Canadian cardiac surgeon. He wrote this book entitled Cold Hearts. A quote from this book: "Humility is an open-mindedness which is acquired by an understanding of the meager state of our knowledge in relation to the vastness and elusiveness of the ultimate truth." So it gives me great pleasure now to welcome Glenn Van Arsdale to the stage, who will introduce our guest lecturer for the Bigelow Lecture this year. And in advance of that, I just want to welcome the Bigelow family. So I know Pixie's here and a number of other family members, so we welcome you at this lecture as well. Glenn. Well, it gives me great pleasure to introduce you, Professor Magda Yacoub, who will give us a lecture entitled The Promise and Threat of Science in Medicine. I'm not going to say a lot about Dr. Bigelow other than that I had an opportunity to meet with him about 20 years ago when I was a nobody. And he took the time to tell me, you know, one of the famous stories of his career, and it was just a beautiful interaction that you know, young surgeons cherish when they get to meet one of the heroes in cardiac surgery. But I do want to take a little time to talk to you about Professor Magda Yacoub, who is currently professor at the National Heart Lung Institute, Imperial College. He's director of research at the Harefield Heart Science Center, also known as the Magda Yacoub Institute, where he directs 60 scientists looking at tissue engineering, regenerative medicine, stem cell biology, heart failure, and transplantation immunology. He's the founder and director of the Magda Yacoub Foundation, which has a number of functions. One is it's established a major heart medical center in Aswan, Egypt, where they deliver free cardiac care, top-notch training, and have a developing science program. He's the founder of Chain of Hope, which is a charity that provides congenital cardiac surgery to war-torn nations and developing nations, and also brings patients to the UK for treatment. Prior to that, from 1969 to 2001, he was an NHS consultant for cardiac surgery, mostly at the Harefield and Brompton hospitals. He has more than 1,000 scientific papers. He established a major heart, lung, and lung transplantation program with over 2,500 cases and was a clear leader in that field for decades. He designed or had first in 10 operations, and for more than 20 years, he was a British Heart Foundation professor. For all of this work, he was knighted by the Queen in 1991. In 1998, he became a fellow of the Academy of Medical Sciences. In 1999, became a fellow in the Royal Society. In 1999, he also had a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Secretary of State for Health. In 2014, the Order of Merit by the Queen. And in 2015, the Lister Medal. In 2016, the American Heart Association International Impact Award. It's a little bit hard to do his career justice in a few sentences. He was a legend in his time. He was ferocious and is ferocious in his passion for the field and for science. And perhaps I'll tell you a few stories about his legend that will give you a little flavor. So he was famous for incredibly hard work. Calling the operating room, get the patient on the table, I'll be flying on the Concorde and landing, be ready to go when I get there. That was a typical story. One of the famous stories that I actually love is having a scientific meeting at 10:30 at night. Meanwhile, next door, the chest was open, the patient was waiting for him to come and do the CABG, or whatever the operation was at the night. Now, some of these stories may be apocryphal, but I will tell you a true story, firsthand, from the person it happened to. A famous surgeon in our field went to visit Professor Magdi Yacoub, as many surgeons had done over the years. As he went through customs and immigration in London, they said, what are you doing? Well, I'm here to visit Professor Yacoub, and pretty much everybody knows Professor Yacoub. And, well, you're not here to operate, right? Your visa is strictly to visit. No, I'm here just to visit. That's all I'm going to do. Now, you understand you cannot operate while you're here. Is that correct? I understand. No, I'm strictly here to visit Professor Yacoub. And so he goes and visits Professor Yacoub's unit. And as he's standing there watching in the room next door, all hell breaks loose with blood splattering out the ceiling. Professor Yacoub looks up at Richard Jonas and says, Richard, can you scrub for me, please? Needless to say, he did. Professor Yacoub, we're really delighted that you came to spend time with us and to honor Professor Bigelow.
F5.
Thank you very much indeed for your kind and humbling words. I am really deeply aware of the honor bestowed upon me to deliver this lecture in this institution. I'm actually full of awe because this institution has acted as a beacon for many generations. And as for Dr. Bigelow, you just heard, he has also been a source of inspiration. And I have had the great honor of meeting Dr. Bigelow and being inspired by his work as a young resident in London and listening to him almost exactly that story you have just heard. And his lecture at the Royal College of Surgeons in London was entitled Intellectual Humility. That had just stuck in my mind and had been again something which guided many people, not just me. And so Dr. Bigelow was something really so big, so I don't know that I am qualified to give the Bigelow lecture. Maybe small compared to this time. I later on came and visited this institution, and again I was really body surgeon and Dr. Bigelow himself showed me around. Like you, what you said, I felt a massive oath to the man. The title of my talk this morning is The Glory and Threat of Science and Medicine. And I will show you a few examples why this is the case. And these are the topics I'm going to talk about. And there are other people who has had a profound interest, influence on my life. One of them was Sir Karl Popper. And Karl Popper is one of the philosophers in the 20th century who is said to have had the biggest influence on our thinking, and he has authored many books like The Open Society and its enemies, and the Conjectures and Refutations, which I love, a book which is massively important. And in that particular book, he talks about science, as we all know almost, that science is the search for the truth, and that truth is beautiful. That has been articulated by many philosophers throughout history. I'll show you more about that. But then he will go on to say that truth, as we have just had, is unachievable. So what do? We are satisfied for the time being with current knowledge, but strive for more knowledge in the future. And he talks about that in so doing, we should be advancing theories and conjectures, and the title of the book is Conjectures and Refutations, but then not try and prove them, try and refute them. And if we don't, thank God there are other people, our peers, come quickly to help us try to refute. But thank you, peers, and because you're propelling us towards the truth. We should never be sorry about that. Another giant who had a massive interest on me, influence on me, is the late Sir Peter Medawar. And Sir Peter, again, I had the incredible luck and pleasure to meet Sir Peter in Chicago. And then when I went back to London, I rang him again as a junior consultant. And said, Sir Peter, can I come and talk to you? Oh, my dear chap, come and have lunch with me tomorrow. And Sir Peter also, apart from winning the Nobel Prize for his work on transplant biology, because without him there would be no transplantation, because he was the first to show in 1952 in a seminar paper in Nature entitled Induction of Specific Immune Tolerance. More about that. And that was by Billingham, Brent, and Medawar, and there are many stories about them from Billingham, the first author of the paper on Nature, and how Sir Peter analyzed everything and pushed him to be the first. So I don't know anything about the topic, you write the paper. And that opened the way for transplantation, because it showed that the immune system is not invincible. But the tragedy is, it opened the way for non-specific immune problems. His paper is induction-specific immune problems, which we are still trying to do, but we are still using non-specific immune problems. Enough of that. Many of these books in philosophy, biology, humanity, etc. And one of his statements is the rule of creativity. And he said, it is the art of producing ostensibly out of nothing, something of beauty. It starts with beauty, order, or significance. This is a profound statement which many of the young people here can pursue. And that's what Sir Peter has left us many, many times. This is just to show you in my native Egypt, the ancient Egyptian realized two things. One is that the truth is beautiful. And this is Maat, the goddess of the truth. As you can see, she's very, very good. But equally, like Karl Popper saying, the truth is unachievable. If you came near Maat, she grows these huge wings and flies away in pursuit of the truth, which is not achievable. These were the ancient Egyptians 3,500 years ago. They knew what they were doing. We don't know. Somehow. Now, I have already talked. I've already talked about Karl Popper and the conjecture computations ideas, but also the idea of intellectual humility, which we have heard about this morning more than once, and that has been articulated by many of the philosophers of science, saying that really we should be intellectually humble, otherwise there would be no discoveries. I could go on about this for a long time, but I won't. I will go straight to the glory of science. Really, I've been talking to some of the younger colleagues yesterday and this morning here, and saying how really lucky we are to be associated with science and medicine, because there are so many wonderful things which can happen, like discovery, healing. My God, this is what an incredible privilege to be associated with this process of so-called healing, even if we don't achieve it completely. Teaching, passing on knowledge, and most importantly, human interaction between people all over the world. So that's incredible glory. But at the same time, there are threats, because once you have a powerful instrument like either science or medicine, you can do a lot of harm, either knowingly or unknowingly. You can do false discoveries, either on purpose or without knowing. This is bad. We were talking again with the colleagues about over-recognition, that people keep talking, saying what a hero you are. And if you believe that, then you are in big trouble. Destructive competition, which is very well known to all of us. Most importantly, losing contact with the patient, which is just happening all the time in our current society because of a simple fact, and that is medicine is being treated as a commodity, particularly I'm afraid on this side of the country. And people buy your services, so you're a commodity. This is a disaster because it's a big loss to the patient, but a big loss to the doctor as well. And unless this, something has to be done about this. Now, I like this lessons from the Titan story, because in the Greek mythology, there are many incredible lessons, and this is one of them. And I'm sure many of you know the story from the Greek mythology, where Prometheus looked down to the earth and saw men crouched in caves, half naked, cold and shivering, and asked Uranus, quite frankly, why Eurenius took his father away? Why has he kept the human race in ignorance and darkness in the caves?
Staff call for Dr. Shua Luo of cardiovascular surgery to critical care unit. Staff call for Dr. Shua Luo of cardiovascular surgery to critical care unit. Staff call for Shua Luo of cardiovascular surgery to critical care unit.
Uranus, the father, said, what you call ignorance is innocence, my friend, as long as no one convinces them that they are not happy, they are happy. Now, I think the people crouched in caves, half naked and cold, are people with heart failure, who were cold and shivering, and the darkness was our ignorance. Anyway, what Prometheus did was, you know the story, he went to the sun and got a branch and lit the caves and introduced warmth. And he was punished, of course, by Uranus having a vulture come and feed on his liver every night. So he wakes up in the morning with no liver. But the wonders of stem cell biology, he grew up another liver. Now, one of the giants in cardiac surgery and in medicine and science is, who will be known for many of you, of course, is Aldo Castaneda. And Aldo, in his presidential address to the American Association of Thoracic Surgeons, talked about the training of a cardiac surgeon or a physician as an Apollonian quest. I like that because it brings Greek mythology again. And Aldo said that it is an Apollonian quest because Apollo, to develop intellect, the arts, and healing, implies harmony, balance, rationality, loyalty, and discipline, all required in the training of a cardiac surgeon, or a physician, or indeed a scientist. So that's our goal for you. Now, I like to just quote heart transplantation as an example of the glory and threats of science and medicine. Because only 60 years ago, or just before, I mean, we're celebrating the 50th year of the first heart transplant this year, and it was considered to be a fantasy for the future, fantasy, but fantasy no more. With the introduction, it's now 50 years, clinical introduction, enthusiastic reception, moratorium, steady progress, a qualified success. Why do I say a qualified success? Because the success is again the mixture of the glory and threat. It's now still the gold standard, both in terms of survival and quality of life for patients with severe heart failure. There are patients who entered the Guinness Book of Records by surviving 34 years after heart, 32 years after heart lung transplantation. And that is fantastic success in something which was, when it was being introduced, people were thinking, oh, we'd be lucky to give them 5 years. And now they have 34 years. But there are limitations or threats, which are the shortage of donor organs, and you're working on that, and the fact that non-specific immune tolerance, because the dream of Sir Peter Medawar in 1952, I ask you, has not been achieved, and so the non-specific immune suppression produces 100-fold increase in cancer, infection, renal failure. But it really is a qualified success. We are not there yet. We need a lot of young people like in this room to try to come to the rescue. We have to get. This is Sir Peter Medawar. I talked about him already. Shortage of donor organs are being addressed by several strategies. It is Sir Peter himself who was born to a Lebanese father, an English mother, in Rio de Janeiro, educated at Oxford, and as he puts it in his book, Memoirs for Thinking Radish, you can't get all mixed up with that. But nevertheless, he has shown the way in a big, big, big way. This is Peter Medawar in his younger days. And he says, and I quote, "It is the great glory, as it is the great threat of science, that everything which is in principle possible can be done if the intention to do so is sufficiently resolute." So obviously we are not sufficiently resolute, but young people probably will supply this with being sufficiently resolute. Transplantation has given birth to other branches of science, like the regeneration, which is defined as either rejuvenating existing myocardium by cell division, or we create new myocardium through cell therapy, myocardial cell division, direct reprogramming. Time will not allow me to go through that, but I'm sure many of the young people are going into these avenues of improve existing myocardium by these strategies, or having these changes in the myocardium, which we lump them under a big heading of reverse remodeling. And we have many players